that assures that I'm not alone. Yes, and I don't like to be alone also. At least when we are discussing Bhagavad Gita, we have to be in association. Machitta madgata prana bodayanta parasparam. Together in association, we discuss Krishna Katha. This comes in the 10th chapter. But we are in a very, very important chapter today. All right. So before we begin with prayers, I wanted to tell all of you something very interesting. Yes. And that very interesting point is that the essence of Vedas, yes, or the crown of the Vedas is the Upanishad. And there are 108 Upanishads. And the most important Upanishad amongst all the Upanishads is Gita Upanishad. So the essence of Vedas is Upanishad. The essence of Upanishad is Gita Upanishad. And the essence of Gita Upanishad or Bhagavad Gita is the middle 6 chapters of Bhagavad Gita, which is, yes, which is Bhakti Yoga. And we have been dealing with Bhakti Yoga since last many sessions. So 7 chapter and 8 chapter is something we have completed. So chapters from 7 to 12 is Bhakti Yoga, and we have completed 2 chapters successfully. So we are in this Bhakti Yoga section. All right. And even in Bhakti Yoga, right, this middle 6 chapters of Gita, the most important chapter is chapter number, any guesses? Let me see all of your guessing. Yes, Anand Prabhu.
Chapter number 9.
Hari Bol, he's confident. We are going to discuss chapter 9. So that must be it. You're right. Chapter 9. So chapter 9 is something that is having 34 shlokas. And the essence of the 9th chapter is something that we'll find out. And there's one shloka which is the essence of the 9th chapter, which I'm going to keep it as suspense. So what we discussed, the essence of Vedas is Upanishad. The essence of Upanishad is Gita. Sarva Upanishado Gavo Dogda Gopala Nandana Parthavatsa Sudhir Bhokta Dugdam Gita Amrutam Mahat. So the essence of Upanishad is Gita. And the essence of Gita is the first, the middle 6 chapters. And even among the middle 6 chapters, the essence of these middle 6 chapters is there in the 9th chapter. And even 9th chapter, there is one shloka which is the essence of it. So in this 9th chapter, we are going to be experiencing the essence of 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 Vedas. Yes, so ready? All right, we'll start with prayers. Om Ajnanatimirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshuhurunmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Nama Om Vishnupadaya Krishna Prishthaya Bhutale Shrimate Bhaktivedanta Swamin Itinamine Namaste Saraswate Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Pashyat Deshatarine वांछा कल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपा सिंधोभ्य एवच पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्तवृंद हरे कृष्ण कृष्ण हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे Hare Krishna. Okay. So last time when we discussed the 8th chapter, we discussed something really exciting. A yogi can rise up his pranavayu through yoga, and thus he can exit his body from the Sahasra Brahmarandra. From here. We have seen many photographs also. A yogi sitting like this and the soul leaving the body from here. Yes, from this point, Sahasra Brahmaranda. And then he can go to any spiritual destination that he wants, any destination. Yes, he can control that. But we need to understand that if this yogi wants to pass on ahead to the spiritual destination, that means beyond this material universe, then there is a condition apply. Not just a condition apply, there are 3 conditions apply. Number one, the time should be that of daytime. Only in daytime can this fellow pass on to the next dimension. Number two, nighttime name, the daytime. Number two, it should be in the waxing of the moon sex. There are two sides of a month, right? There is a waxing, which is called Shukla Paksha, and there is waning, which is called as Krishna Paksha. So when the yogi lives in Krishna Paksha, only then he can pass on to the spiritual destination. Second condition. And number three, the sun should be there in the northern hemisphere. That's called Uttarayan. If the sun is there in the southern hemisphere, which is called Dakshinayan, in that southern movement, even at that point of time, if the soul passes, he will return. So he has to go when the sun is there in the upper part of the universe, part of the hemisphere. So these are the three conditions which a mystic yogi has to fulfill in order to go to the spiritual destination. Three conditions, right? And what if he does not fulfill even one condition? Out of these three conditions, if he is not able to fulfill even one condition, what happens? Any idea? What do you all feel? What happens?
He doesn't achieve the spiritual destination.
Definitely, but what does he achieve? Kuch to milna chahiye na, consolation prize to milna chahiye. Cannot.
Does he come back to this material world?
He returns back to material world, but he does get, you get something. Kuch milta hai. He goes to moon planet. He goes to moon planet for a long duration. Yes. Heavenly planets. You're right. Deepak Prabhu. So you go there and there you enjoy for some time and then you return back. So there is no, that is not a permanent destination. Right. So after explaining all this, Lord Krishna tells that my devotee, a bhakta, should be least bothered about three kinds of conditions, right? My bhakta, whenever he leaves, don't worry. I will personally come to take him, escort him to spiritual world. See, when it comes to the other yogis, they need the support of demigods. See, when Dakshinayan happens, there is called Devashi. There is a Ekadashi called Devashayana Ekadashi. This means demigod, sleep off. Devashayana Ekadashi. They all slept off. So they are not awake, they will not be helped to help him to go to the upper realm. So they like that, there is a condition. In even in Krishna Paksha, the demigods are not in power, the Pitras are in power. The demigods are in power in the Shukla Paksha. That is when they are drinking somras and they're powerful. Yeah. So like this condition, even the daytime is the time where demigods are powerful, even on earth. Even on earth, there are certain functionality should be done in the daytime. In the nighttime, it doesn't count. It doesn't count. Oh, my God. So, itna sab kuch karke, suppose he's trying his best. He's held his pranavayu, Uttarayan, satisfied. Everything satisfied. Just nighttime, he leaves the body. Finished. All fail. On the other hand, a bhakta has to be least bothered about all this because Krishna is personally going to tell. And but what kind of bhakta is this? What kind of bhakta? So, Krishna says, I do this for a bhakta who's called as Ananya Bhakta. What bhakta? Ananya Bhakta. And about this Ananya Bhakta, Krishna has spoken in the 8th chapter of Bhagavad Gita on a couple of occasions. Ananya Chetaha Satatam Yomam Smarati Nityasaha Tasyaham Sulavapartha Nitya Yogasya Yoginaha. So I am very, very easily achievable for my Ananya Bhaktas. And these Ananya Bhaktas should be least bothered about these three conditions. So now one may be very eager to understand who are these Ananya Bhaktas? Who are these guys? Yes. So don't worry much because 9th chapter will be speaking about what is Ananya Bhakti. So the subject matter of the 9th chapter is what is this Ananya Bhakti? So that is a link from 8th chapter to the 9th chapter. What exactly is this Ananya Bhakti? Right? So before Krishna speaks about what is Ananya Bhakti or who are my Ananya Bhaktas, first Krishna wants to glorify the knowledge that he's about to give about Ananya Bhakti. Just like 7th chapter, there are a lot of similarities between 7th chapter and 9th chapters. Many of the topics will be definitely revisited. We're going to revisit many topics, but the 9th chapter is much more confidential, much more deep and much more detailed than the 7th chapter of Bhagavad Gita. So first Krishna will glorify the knowledge of Ananya Bhakti that he's about to give. So how does he glorify? Let's find out. So first, Krishna wants to give exactly, in one sense, who is the one who is qualified to receive this knowledge of Ananya Bhakti. Yes, what is the qualification? Let's read. Shri Bhagavan Uvacha Idam Tute Guhyatamam Pravakshyami Anusuyave Jnanam Vijnana Sahitam Yajnatva Moksha Sesh Ashubat. Yes.
The Supreme Personality of Godhead said, "My dear Arjuna, because you are never envious of me, I shall impart to you this most confidential knowledge and realization, knowing which you shall be relieved of the miseries of material existence."
Yes, so this shloka contains a lot of bit of information. Okay, the first thing that he's speaking is, I'm going to give you guhya tamam. What's the meaning of guhya? Guhya is a very, very simple word. Guhya means confidential. That is guhya. Guhya tara means more confidential. And then there is guhya tama, means most confidential. So the knowledge that I'm going to give you is not guhya gyan or guhya tara gyan. It is guhya tama gyan. The topmost. The most confidential knowledge. And that's the very name of the section. Many ask, Prabhu, why is this most confidential knowledge? Because Krishna says it. Krishna is telling, I'm going to give the most confidential knowledge. That's it. That is something pravakshami, I'm going to speak. But in order to equip yourself with this particular knowledge about Ananya Bhakti, the most confidential knowledge, you have to have one more qualification. One qualification, that is anasuyave. What is anasuyave? What is Anasuyave? Anasuya. We have heard this name. Somebody having this name, Anasuya.
Envious.
Non-envious. Not envious at all. Yes, Mataji, not envious. Asuya is envy. Anasuya is non-envious. So this qualification is, anybody wanting to understand Ananya Bhakti should be Anasuya. Anasuya. Non-envious. Okay. And then what is upcoming? What is upcoming is, see, I'm not just going to give you Guhyatama Gyan. Guhyatama Gyan is most confidential knowledge. I'm also going to give you the most confidential realization. Both. Jnanam Vijnana Sahitam. Along with Vijnana. Along with realization, something I'm going to be packaging and giving you. Which means it will not just be theory. It will also be practical. Yes? So moment we say colleges, schools, whatever courses we went, there has to be theory, paper and practical also along with that, right? So Krishna is telling, even this Ananya Bhakti matter, you will definitely find both. There is theory and there is also practical. Practical along with theory. So this is something which will not be theoretical. Don't worry. The most confidential knowledge and the most confidential realization. The most confidential theory and those most confidential practicals. Both I'm going to offer it to you. What is the result of it? What happens if I get this most confidential knowledge? What is the result? Yajnatva. If you know this, moksha se ashubhat. All varieties of inauspiciousness is finished. Yajnatva, moksha se ashubhat. And what exactly is ashubha, which is being spoken? Can you all try to help me out? What is ashubha? Don't tell me the meaning. Meaning is something we all know. But what is Krishna referring to when he talks about Ashubha or something that is inauspicious? What is he talking about? Anybody?
Material.
Material, please complete.
Our material existence.
Material existence. Little more deeper. You're right, but little more. Material existence will end. That means as soon as you get the knowledge, zoop, gone. The person is, where is he? Gayab ho gaya. He's gone to the spiritual world. Congratulations. No, it's not like that. Material what? Material existence, but what does the material existence provide you with?
Our desire will be fulfilled, purified.
Okay, that's Good. He just went in this direction. Now he came, took a reverse gear. Okay, Suryakant, we'll give a chance to others. Fine. Dukkhas. Okay.
Miseries, material miseries.
Yes, material miseries. There are threefold miseries everybody has to suffer. They are the Ashubha. The Adhyatmika Klesha, the misery because of one's own mind and body. Adhibhautika Klesha, the miseries because of other living entities around. And Adhidaivika Kleshas, which are miseries because of the material nature, the environment. So all three miseries, one can completely put an end to all of these three things when one gets the knowledge of this most confidential knowledge. One gets the most confidential knowledge of the ninth chapter. Great. So we are all set to hear the ninth chapter. We want to end this threefold miseries. We don't want it. Yes. But for that, we have to realize, you have to apply also. It's not just good to know. Krishna said, Jnanam Vijnana Sahitam. Krishna is going to teach many, many practical aspects as we go along, but we need to apply that as well. All right. So now one may be very excited. Well, we got to know the result of knowledge. We got to know the qualification of a person. We have many times envy in heart. Envy is there. What to do? But at least one should not have envy towards Krishna directly. Krishna's personality, we should not have envy. Yes, we can start off with that. And slowly, slowly, we will work towards it. And if you are envious of other fellow beings, in one sense, because everybody is a part and parcel of Krishna, envying another being is also envying Krishna. Because part and parcel of Krishna. So you're envying a finger of Krishna, suppose. That's envying Krishna only, right? So we should not have envy for any part and parcel. But how do we become non-envious? Yes, non-envious. How do we become this? Well, even through the practice of Ananya Bhakti, one will become non-envious. But an immediate practice that one can do very practically at the time being is actually to appreciate. Because envy's another name is indirect appreciation. Yeah, envy is actually indirect appreciation. So why not appreciate directly? So if we directly appreciate, then there is no envy. So that is the end. There is a lecture given by my spiritual master. He says, appreciation and glorification, the antidote for envy. Yes. So envy is also a pandemic. Pandemic. Yes, it's a pandemic. And the vaccination for the pandemic is appreciation. So when we appreciate, that envy is curbed completely. So next time we experience this, we should take care that we do appreciate. All right. So now before Krishna starts giving the knowledge, he gives the characteristics of knowledge. Because now he just mentioned that anybody who knows this knowledge, the result of knowing this knowledge is moksha se ashubhat. You will stop experiencing material miseries. All right. Then what are the characteristics of this knowledge? We are quite eager to know. What you appreciate, appreciates. True. Very nice. What you appreciate, appreciates. But definitely this appreciation will cut off all the envy. So let's try to figure out now what are the characteristics of this knowledge. So before Krishna goes into the knowledge, he gives the characteristics. Okay, let's see. Rajavidya Rajaguhyam Pavitram idam uttamam pratyakshavagamam dharmyam susukham kartumavyayam.
This knowledge is the king of education, the most sacred of all secrets. It is the purest knowledge, and because it gives direct perception of the self by realization, it is the perfection of realism. It is everlasting and it is joyfully performed.
Thank you, Prabhu. Thank you. All right. So what are the first characteristics? This is the king of all knowledges, Raja Vidya. If a person makes friendship with the king, yes, a person makes friendship with the king, then he doesn't have to make friendship with any other person. Right? He gets everything. When you make friendship with the king, you make friendship with the leader, then you make automatically friendship with everybody else. All other people will be favorably disposed to you. That's the thumb rule. So similarly, if you have this Rajavidya, you get this knowledge. This is called Rajavidya because this is the essence of all philosophies. We already discussed this in the beginning. That essence of Vedas is Upanishad. The essence of Upanishad is Gita. Essence of Gita is the first middle six chapters. And the essence of the middle six chapters is the ninth chapter. So that's what we are going to. It's the essence of all philosophy. It's very condensed knowledge. Right? Essence, the very essence. So that is why it is called as Raja Vidya. And if you get this Vidya, then there is absolutely, it is becomes very easy to get all other Vidya. All other knowledge become very easy. So now one may ask Prabhu, then please explain us, what is this Guhya Gyan? What exactly is Guhya Gyan? Or confidential knowledge? Oh, confidential knowledge is that which is explained in chapter number 2 and 3. The characteristics and the functions of the soul. That is chapter 2 and 3 is confidential knowledge. Guhya Gyan. Knowledge and nature of soul. Prabhu, where does chapter 3 describe about nature of soul? No. What? How nature of soul in this world? What kind of nature of soul is there in the world? That is described, right? All right. Then what is more confidential knowledge? More confidential knowledge is to study about the energies of Krishna, which is there in chapter number 7 and 8. Chapter 7 and 8 contains the thorough description of Krishna's material world, spiritual world, material energies and spiritual energies. So that is more confidential knowledge. So Krishna is all the while kept on building up the subject matter. And what is the most confidential knowledge, Prabhuji? That is something we'll study in the 9th chapter. So I'm not going to give you the suspense. It is there. Okay, I'm not going to break the suspense. So that is called as Raja Guhyam. The most secret of all. Guhyatama. The most confidential. Raja Guhyam. That is the second characteristic we discussed just now. We discussed what is Guhya, what is more Guhya. And most Guhya is 9th chapter. Raja Vidya, Raja Guhyam. And third nature. This particular knowledge has the potency just by knowing it can be purifying you. You can be purified. Simple question. What is the date of birth of Sachin Tendulkar? We don't know, Prabhuji. Yeah, okay, okay. Ananthru knows. Yes, please, please, please.
24th April.
24th April? Oh, we just missed by one day. Yesterday was his birthday. 24th April 1970. 73. Okay. 24th April 1973. So we all got some knowledge from Anand Prabhu now. But this knowledge is not purifying in nature. On the other hand, which is the date of birth of Krishna? It's a tricky question. Please think and answer. Date of birth of Krishna. Yes, please answer it. Nobody wants to attempt tricky question.
He is never born.
Yes, Krishna is never born. He is unborn. So how can he have date of birth? Can you say which is the time of birth of the sun? No, it's sunrise. When the sun preferred to rise, that is sunrise. Which is the death of the sun? No, that is sunset. Sun has preferred to set. So there is no birth and death for a sun. Similarly, there is no birth and death for Krishna. But the very fact that you came to know right now that Krishna is unborn, this knowledge has purified all of us. So there is a difference between the knowledge of birth of Sachin Tendulkarji, and there's a difference and great difference between the knowledge that Krishna is unborn. Just to know this. Yes. Janmashtami is the day where he appeared on the in this material existence to display his pastimes. That is appearance of Krishna. Got it, no? So this is also a piece of information which I gave you. That is also purifying. So by hearing these two aspects about Krishna's birth, we have experienced purification from anarthas. So can any other knowledge, can but this, that's what this knowledge is, pavitram idam. Just by hearing this knowledge, you will experience purification of heart. Pavitram idam. And number four, uttamam. Now sometimes people say, uttam, ati uttam. But what is the meaning of uttam? That very few people know. Tama means ignorance. Tama means ignorance. And uttama means that which takes you beyond ignorance. So this knowledge will take one beyond ignorance. So far we have discussed four aspects. Right? Rajvidya, the king of all education. So this is a training which should be given for everyone. And somebody trained in this, definitely he has the essence of all other training. Second, Rajaguhyam, I'm so sorry. Rajaguhyam. We understood that it's the most confidential knowledge. I also explained what is confidential and more confidential. Number three, just by knowing this knowledge, you become purified. Pavitram. Yes. And number four, many people say, are uttamam, ati uttam. What is uttamam? Uttamam, matlab tamam. Tamam means ignorance. Uttamam means jo aapko tamam se utha deta hai. You can go beyond ignorance. That is called as uttamam. So these are the four characteristics. What is the fifth one? Pratyakshavagamam. Yes. Pratyakshavagamam means we will be able to directly experience this knowledge. You can experience it anytime, any place, as soon as you apply. Now, if I tell you, the sky has 4 million stars. Count karo jao, baith ke. Person keeps going 1, 2, 3, 4. Can you experience it? The sky has 4 million stars. No, you have to accept it. The population of India is 125 crores. Even that also people will not have patience to count. Nahi, we'll accept whatever. Bola na, take it, accept it. Correct? It's just accepted. We cannot experience that. Can you experience 125 crore population together? Coming at one place? No, it will be a very dangerous thing to do for it to happen. We can only just, we have to accept this kind of knowledge. But bhakti is not dogmatic like this. That bol diya, accept karlo. Bas. No. Krishna is saying pratyakshavagamam. You will be able to experience it. Pratyakshavagamam. Not just, they're not just theoretical statements. Each and every one of you can experience. Next characteristic, dharmyam. Dharmyam. What is dharmyam? Dharmyam means this is the perfection of dharma. Okay, now I want to ask you a question. Whenever you talk about this dharma, what picture comes in your mind? What do you visualize usually? Because we are actually, we have visual minds. Yes, we visualize things. So whenever we talk about dharma, what do you visualize?
Yudhishthir Maharaj.
Thank you. Yudhishthir Maharaj. Yeah. Okay, Abhishek Prabhu, Krishna Kumar Prabhu, together they said Yudhishthir Maharaj. Kya baat hai? Think. Anyone else? Other than Yudhishthir Maharaj, please.
Lord Ramachandra,
okay. Maryada Purushottam. Anyone else? Nothing comes to mind? Aisa ho hi nahi sakta, it's cheating. We all think, if I tell you don't think of red elephant, the first thing you have done is you already thought of red elephant. Aisa, Ambarish Maharaj, okay. Dharma means Ambarish Maharaj for you.
Vidurji.
Okay, Dinesh Prabhu is saying Vidurji, Mahatma Vidur. Thank you, Dinesh Prabhu. One more answer, last. Amit Kaliaji Prabhu says Bharat. Okay, Bharat. Dharma, he followed Dharma. Okay, we got answers. I had similarly asked in one of the classrooms, what do you imagine Dharma? One boy said, you, sir. Sanatan Dharma. I thought somebody will tell my name. Just joking. Koi to bolega mera naam. So Dharma. My name also, there is Dharma, right? So that boy said, sir, I think of you. Dharma matlab, Sanatan Dharma. All right. Yes. So Dharma means whatever you all spoke, they are all symbols of dharma or emblems of dharma. But if you see, dharma is something which is called as the duties to be performed by mankind. They are called as dharma. Many dharmas are there. There is three dharma, there is Raja dharma, Varnashrama dharma, Kula dharma. Many things, many dharmas. But the cream of all the dharmas, which is to be performed by everybody, is dash. Which dharma? Bata do na, please. Let's see who will say it.
Sanatana dharma.
Yeah, correct. Because that is the duty. They are the duties, eternal duties of the soul. So what Krishna is telling, he is going to teach, is Sanatana Dharma. Dharmyam means the best of all dharmas, Sanatana Dharma. Okay, so that is the characteristic number, konsa? 5, 4, 5, kitna? 6, 6, yeah, 6 characteristics. Okay, let's see what is the 7th one. Susukham, wow. That means when you actually practice this dharma, you should be happy while doing it. So we are all going to try, Prabhuji. We all are going to try. And if you are not happy, we'll catch you. Nay, don't catch me. Adjust your dharma. You are not doing it properly. Yes. Sometimes some exercises appear while doing exercising. Yes, while doing exercise, some exercise appear very easy. Are to asan lag raha ekdam. Like my college days, I had gone to gym with my roommate. Yes, I had habit of going every day. So my roommate came to gym. Kya hai dekhte hain? And then he started easily doing it. Dekho, main to itne aasani se kar raha hu. You are, you know, you are taking so much of strain to do it. And I am doing it very easily. Kya hai? What? I am more stronger than you. Like that, he said, main to kabhi nahi aata gym. Pehli bar aa raha hu. I said, wait a minute. Then I checked behind, the pin was, you know, you have to pin it. Right? You have to pin the weights. It was unpinned. It was removed. Somebody removed and went. Bola, theek hai, abhi aata hu, 1 minute. Then I put it. Put it down, ekdam, all weights, up karke dikhao. He was not even able to move. Abhi kya ho gaya? Suddenly itna bhari kaise ho gaya? Previously kuch gadbad tha. There's something wrong. Similarly, in our practice of this confidential knowledge, if we are not feeling happy, very happy, in fact, Krishna says, susukham, the practitioner will be really happy. Nahi ho raha, it doesn't mean Krishna is lying. It doesn't mean I am lying. I am cooking it up. No. It means there is something wrong with our practice. Something is wrong with our practice. So we have, that is why we need a mentor, a guide, a guru who will keep telling us kahan gadbad ho raha hai, why it is not happening. Right? Why that susukham is not happening. So that is it. Okay. So sukham kartum, that is a characteristic number 7. So far 7, right? And the last one is avyayam. Right? Avyayam. Now this avyayam is a very, very hopeful statement. That means whatever you are performing, it's going to bear permanent result. Avyayam, the results cannot be destroyed. In this world, whatever you do cannot bear permanent result. Whatever. Every result will die out after some time. Correct? Somebody wants to stay in a place, you pay the rent. We cannot say that I paid the rent, I will stay here forever. No, you, after 1 month, you don't renew it. You will have to quit the place. Similarly, one may say, okay, Prabhu, I'll go for a permanent house. But please understand, even in this material world, permanent house, how many of you knew it? The flat, apartments, I know this reality. I'm a person who does Siddhi Bath. The flat, apartments, wherever we stay, that's going to shake and go off in about 50, 60 years. Even that is not permanent. Such a permanent house, Prabhuji, that's only in paper permanent. It's not like that. The materials constructed are such a way, they are there in such a way that it has to fall, the building will fall. It's not a permanent house. Correct? So nothing bears permanent result in this particular world. You get a job. Yes, you may last in the job, but after 60, not a permanent job, right? Out. So many people want, in India, there's a trend that people are nowadays switching to government job. Permanent. Yes, permanent. But what is the, it does not happen, but what is the guarantee we can say that everything will be peaceful? What is the guarantee India will not be colonized again? Yes, some other power coming and taking over. Correct, then is it permanent? Government is also not permanent. Kaise hoga? So nothing is permanent. But what is Krishna telling? If you gain and practice this knowledge, then the effect of it is permanent. That's the beauty of avyayam. Can we have a quick recall? Because it's a very, very important verse. Anybody quickly putting it in the mic or in the chat, both are fine. Some quick recall of what exactly are the qualities or characteristics that you remember. We discussed 8 of them.
Rajavidya.
Okay, one by one. Let we'll give everyone a chance. So Raj Vidya, the king of all knowledge. All right. Because it contains the essence of everything. Next, anybody else? Okay, Raja Guhyam. Sushma Mataji. He says Raja Guhyam, the most confidential secret. Okay, next. Avyayam, the latest one. Okay, fine. Anyone else? Purest, Pavitram. Uttamam. Very good. So far, we have done 5. Anyone else?
Dharmam.
Dharmyam, correct. It's the it's the very purpose of dharma. Very nice. Susukham.
Susukham.
Yes, very nice. Last, kaun sa missing kar rahe? The one which is a tongue twister. Pratyakshavagamam. Pratyakshavagamam. Many people, it's Pratyakshavagamam. Pratyaksha agamam. So Pratyaksha agamam. Whenever we find difficulty to pronounce Sanskrit words, break it down. Pratyaksha agamam. So this is really tongue twister. Pratyaksha agamam. So this is the place where shloka, many of them get confused. Pratyaksha agamam. Direct. Okay. So these are the 8 characteristics of the knowledge. So this is something we have digested. Now one may be asking a question. Prabhuji. Question. If bhakti is so sukham, so nice, it's direct. We've seen so many advantages. Still, why there are some people who don't practice this? Kyun? This must be really a doubt, na? Why? Why is it that even after such wonderful characteristics, why people are not practicing this path? Or why people don't take up to this? Next question. The question is in, answer is in number 3, shloka number 3. Ashraddhanaah purusha dharmasyasya parantapa apraapyamam nivartante mrityu samsara vartmani.
Those who are not faithful in the devotional service cannot attain me, O conqueror of enemies. Therefore, yes, they return to the path of birth and death in this material world.
Wow. So, here Krishna is telling that people who are faithless, ashraddhadana purusha, so these are the people who actually do not take to this process of religion. Dharmasya asya parantapa. Hey parantapa, hey Arjuna. This kind of dharma, they don't take path. Faithlessness. People are faithless. Well, then what do such people do then? What happens to such people? Well, what happens to such people? I'll tell you, apraapyamam nivartante. They will not attain me. Then what will happen? Mrityu samsara vartmani. Again and again, they will take birth in this material existence. Ashraddhadhana. So what is this? What exactly is this ashraddhadhana? Yes. That ashraddhadhana is actually, okay, we'll try to understand what is shraddhadhana. Shraddha shabde vishwasa koi sudhruda nishchoy. Krishna bhakti koile sarva karma krito hai. Shraddha means that if I serve Krishna, yes, or if I serve Krishna's devotees, Krishna and Krishna's devotees are together always. If I serve them, then I will get everything. I don't need to worship some other demigod. Or if I serve Krishna and all other his devotees, then I will get achieve all perfection. I'll go back to Godhead. So this is faith. And a person not having this faith, unfortunately, such a person will not practice this knowledge. You'll not practice this knowledge. So this is also one of the qualification which Krishna gives if one wants to go ahead on this path, and that's faith. But definitely faith can be cultivated. Faith can be cultivated with knowledge. When we give knowledge, faith is generated. And when faith is generated, eventually surrender develops. So knowledge, faith, surrender. That's the path. So person has to be ready to apply the knowledge and get faith. So person who doesn't apply the knowledge will not get faith. So then such a person will remain ashraddhana, not faithful, and mrityu samsara vartmani, one will keep proceeding in this material world. So this is the reason we find that many people do not take up to the path because of faithlessness. Yes, so this is also another qualification that we see we should take care. For ananya bhakti, we have to be faithful. All right. So now Krishna is going to speak. He's going to start speaking a few aspects about himself. Something is going to talk about himself, after hearing which one will develop ananya bhakti for Krishna. So he would like to start off with his greatness. Because you get to know how great a person is, we will definitely rever that person, respect that person, and respect, worship that person. So Krishna is going to reveal his Aishwarya, his greatness, his opulences, through which one may become an Ananya Bhakta, or one will definitely, if one understands this properly. So he starts explaining about his Aishwarya. So let's see the fourth verse. Maya tadamidam sarvam jagat avyakta murtina matstani sarva bhutani nachaham teshvavastitah.
By me, in my unmanifested form, this entire universe is pervaded. All beings are in me, but I am not in them.
So what is Krishna telling here? All beings are in me, but I am not in them. Well, I would like to comment on this verse after we discuss the next verse. Nacha matstani bhutani pashyame yogam aishwaryam bhutabhrin nacha bhutasto mamatma bhutabhavanah.
And yet everything that is created does not rest in me. Behold, my mystic opulence, although I am the maintainer of all living entities and although I am everywhere, I am not a part of this cosmic manifestation, for myself is the very source of creation.
Oh, so Krishna is telling everything is created doesn't exist in me. Ha ha ha. And here he says that all beings are in me, but I am not in them. What is exactly this? And over here he tells, everything that is created doesn't exist in me. Yes, although I am everywhere. So we need to discuss and understand this a little bit. So what is exactly Krishna trying to tell? He's trying to confuse us. It will be confusing if we study without guidance. But we have a lot of guidance from Srila Prabhupada's purports, which fortunately we have studied. So we'll try to explain with that. Maya tadam idam sarvam. So here Krishna is telling that I pervade this whole universe. Sarvam. Idam always refers to material universe. Yes, material universe. So I am pervading this whole material universe. I am present everywhere. I am in everything. I have covered everything. I am energizing everything. I am there. Oh, try to see. Everybody, please try to see if you are able to see Krishna. Try it. Just try now once for me. Look around. Just try if you're able to see Krishna. Now you got the knowledge, na? Pratyaksha. You're not even trying. Everyone is looking at the screen. No, Prabhu, we know. We'll not make a fool out of ourselves. But Krishna is telling the next line. Jagat avyakta murtina. But that form is avyakta murtina. You will not be able to see. That's why you all didn't try. Because you knew the next line. So Krishna is telling, although I am everywhere, I am present in my invisible form. Jagat avyakta murtina, that form which you cannot see with your material eyes. They are invisible to material senses. But I am there. I am there. So this requires faith, right? This requires faith that God is everywhere, but he cannot be visible. And that's why in the very beginning, before Krishna gives this knowledge, he talks about faith, that you need to keep faith in me. And don't worry, through the process which I'm going to teach, you'll be able to see me everywhere also. And matstani sarvabhutani. What does this mean? This means matstani sarvabhutani, all living entities. Matstani, they are all in me. What does this mean? This means that all the living entities depend on me. That's the meaning. All living entities are in me means they all depend upon me. Matstani sarvabhutani and nachaham teshu avastita. But I don't have to depend on anybody for my existence. That is why Krishna is called as nirapeksha satya, which means whose existence doesn't depend on anyone else. On the other hand, jivatma, so sarvabhutani, they are called as sapeksha satya, which means whose existence depends on the existence of the nirapeksha satya, Krishna. So now this verse is clear. Yes. So Krishna is expanded into every bit of this universe in the form of his energy, his shakti. And that shakti is not visible. Jagat avyakta murtina. You cannot see it. But we need to understand another thing, that Krishna is the very, very source of dependence for all living entities. All living entities have to depend on Krishna. But he doesn't have any dependence on other living entities. That's what he means by this. Is this clear? Clear statement? All right. Now we go to the next one and analyze the next statement. What is Krishna trying to say here? Nacha matstani bhutani. The living entities are not situated into me. Nacha matstani bhutani. Now here previously he said they are all situated in me. But here he is saying everything doesn't created by me, does not rest in me. What does this mean? What is the meaning of this? Oh, this means that Krishna doesn't have something to directly take, give and take with this material creation. He doesn't have to have anything directly with this material creation. Nacha matstani bhutani. Ashyame yoga maishwaram. Just look at my yoga aishwaryam. So this particular knowledge is called as aishwarya jnana. Aishwarya jnana. So pashyame yoga maishwaram. Just see. My aishwaryam bhuta brin nacha bhutasto mamatma bhuta bhavanah. So Krishna is telling that bhuta brin, that means I maintain everyone. Brit bhuta brin, I maintain everybody. This is I do. And nacha bhutasta, but yet I am not a part of the creation. I'm not. Because Krishna is not created. He is the creator, right? He is the very creator. He is the primary creator. So bhuta, but I maintain. His role is maintenance. Nacha bhutasto. I am not a part of this creation. And but who then, who are you? Mamatma bhuta bhavanaha. I am the creator. I am the very person who generated everything. That's why I am not a part of this creation. But I maintain it. That's my yoga aishwaryam. All right. Nacha matstani bhutani. So I am not situated in, everything doesn't rest in me means Krishna is not directly concerned about this material creation. It's happening. It's a part of his separated energy. He has made a lot of good systems. Simple example, I worked at Tata Motors. So if Tata ji does not come, in our time it was Ratan Tata. So Ratan Tata ji, if he doesn't come, is it that Tata Motors will stop running? No, we'll wait. Then only when Ratan Tata ji comes, that time only we'll operate. No, it's not like that. Right? Whether he is in his lake house, whether he is abroad, he is not here in the factory, wherever he is, no matter what. Still, the factory operations, the factories, the plant will definitely operate. Doesn't need his interference. That's what Krishna is trying to tell here. Nacha matstani bhutani means I have created very good system by which I am not directly, I don't need to directly look into the affairs. That's my yoga aishwarya. But at the same time, maintenance is something that only I do. That's why for creation, Krishna has made Brahma as the in charge. For dissolution, he has made Shiva as the in charge. But for maintenance, no, bhuta brin, that I personally do. So there is something that he personally does. Let's look at even ISKCON as an organization. Srila Prabhupada, he instructed disciples to have the first Rath Yatra. So when Prabhupada established ISKCON, the Rath Yatra, well, that devotees did it. Book distribution, Prabhupada used to initially do when he was in India. In the streets of Delhi, he used to go and distribute books. Once even he fainted, he got a stroke, he fainted. So Prabhupada did not, once after going to abroad, he engaged all his disciples in distributing books. So they were distributing Prabhupada books. That also he engaged in terms of energy. Management, Prabhupada never took care of management. He had temple presidents and GBCs who took care of management. And whenever there would be doubts, he would resolve those conflicts. So these are some aspects which the ISKCON as a movement did. Prabhupada guided, but Prabhupada was not directly involved. That means even in absence of Prabhupada, the temple would run. Even in absence of Prabhupada, the book distribution would happen. Everything. But there is something which only Prabhupada did. What is that? His books. That he did not say, come on, you disciple, come here. You write my books. No, my books I can only write. So Prabhupada gave the Bhaktivedanta purports. So this is something that only he did. When he was on the planet, that time he personally initiated disciples. That's something personally he did. And some of the disciples tried to initiate others. Prabhupada said, wait, in the presence of Guru, you should not initiate disciples. He had to teach because they wanted to imitate Prabhupada. Prabhupada is giving mala and giving name, I'll also give. So one fellow thought that, oh, I become very senior, now I'll also start making disciples. Prabhupada said, no. Not when till the time Guru is on the planet. Yes? So like that, things took place. So certain things Prabhupada did personally. And most of the things he delegated. Similarly, Krishna is saying, I've created a very good system by which I need not interfere with each and everything. Got it, right? So this is Yoga Aishwarya Jnana that we are studying. Next verse. So Krishna's inconceivable power is portrayed in last two verses, 4 and 5. So now Krishna is giving a graphic example because we all need example to understand the subject. So Krishna is giving the example. Yatha akashasthito nityam vayus sarvatra gomahan tatha sarvani bhutani matstani iti upadharaya.
Understand that as the mighty wind blowing everywhere, rest always in the sky. All created beings rest in me.
Mm. So in one sense, what is Krishna telling here? Nitya sarva gata sthanuhu. In second chapter, Krishna has told that everywhere, in every single atom, in every single space, what is there? Life is there. Life is everywhere. And similarly, if you see, yatha akasha stito, in akasha stito nityam, in the sky, vayu sarvatra gomahan, in the sky situated is that vayu, that air which is everywhere, which keeps moving. So the air is within the kham, bhumira apa analo vayu kham. So kham means the sky, and vayu means the air. So the air is situated and keeps moving within the space. Right? Similarly, every living entity created by me is situated and resting in me, which means we need to understand that all living entities are situated within Krishna's energy, Krishna's system, Krishna's arrangement. So they all are in me. Like there may be, there is a house owner and there are many tenants. So house owner, he owns something like 8 flats, suppose. And the tenants are staying in each flat, right? All 8 flats, tenants are sitting. And the house owner has a room itself in one of the places. So he has a room. So all the tenants are staying within the property of the house owner. We get it. They may have separate compartmentalization. And it's not that they are staying in the house of the house owner only. No. But they are staying within the property of the house owner. Correct? So we need, thus we need to understand that the all the living entities are resting in me, means they are all resting or they are all residing within Krishna's framework. That is Krishna's energy, Krishna's unit. In that they are staying. So I think the tenants and the house owner example is very befitting. So the entire material world, this whole material world and including this material universe, which is a part of the material world, is all under Krishna's system, which is called as Daivi Dhamma. This is Maya Devi's system. So within the Maya Devi system, everybody is reciting. And what about those who do not reside under Maya Devi's system? Oh, for them, there is Vaikuntha system. System is there. Just like every citizen, we are under state law. So we are all resident, we are all residing in, so many of us are in Pune. So we stay in Pune city. That doesn't mean that, okay, if you stay in Pune city, means on the map, it may look one dot. Where is Pune dot? So everyone is staying in that dot. That is foolishness. Let's all be ek saath rehte hain kya? You all know Pune means it's a city. And city, we are having different localities. Magarpatta city, Kharadi, Amanora, Vimannagar. Like the different places we coming from. Even if you say, okay, main Kharadi, so maybe Kharadi. Okay, both of you from Kharadi? Oh, then you both must be staying together. No, it's not like that. You are in the same place. So similarly, what Krishna is telling, that all of them are resting in me, they're resting in one system of mine. Yes? All right. We will like to pause here and have any questions, if any. Because we have completed one section. We have completed the glory of the knowledge that we are going to receive. At the same time, we have also completed the Aishwarya Jnana. That section, we have completed first part. Next section, how Krishna's Aishwarya Jnana is going to create and destroy, or rather operate this universe. How I operate this universe through my energy. So Krishna has established right now that my system is there within. So how to operate? How I operate the system? That is something he's going to teach. Prabhuji, who were Paramahans Yogananda Ji, Mahavatar Baba, Lahari Maharaj, they were Ananya Bhaktas? Well, I don't know. I first want to know what were their philosophy, what was their practice. Then we may comment. All right. So we cannot judge people, but we can definitely try to analyze their philosophy or their practice that they did. If their philosophy is same as Bhagavad Gita and their practice is what Krishna is telling, then they're Ananya Bhaktas. So we need to know them. Yes, Anuradha Mataji.
Prabhu, not sure if it is relevant to today's class, but anyway, I would ask it. Yeah. So one thing is, whenever in the scripture we have spoken about leaving the body, for the pure devotees, they go back to Vaikuntha, and not so much about Goloka, except Gop Kumar. We haven't heard so much, even in Bhagavatam or other scripture. Why so, Prabhu? Why it is always Vaikuntha and not Golok? You get my question?
Yeah.
I have one more, but you please answer that.
Okay, fine. So we have so many references where people go to Vaikuntha, Vaikuntha, Vaikuntha. Where do we hear? Somebody went to Golok also. Golok Dham chale gaya. Anybody goes there also, Prabhuji? We need to understand. So first thing we need to understand, whenever scriptures speak about Mad Dhamma, Tad Dhamma Paramamma, or Mad Dhamma, Krishna says, it's in one sense, it's one unit. Again, same. I'm going to Pune. But in Pune, there are many areas, right? I'm going to Pune ISKCON temple. There are many temples in Pune also. So we get it. So there may, the scriptures may not be very specific at that time, but one gets the gati as per the rasa. We get it. As per the rasa, one gets the gati. So scriptures may not each and every time be obliged to give the details. So they speak it that way, number one. Number two, we have evidences wherein Goloka Dham is described very nicely also. Brahma Samhita is one scripture where Goloka Dham is described. Yes, at the same time, there is a section, Brihat Bhagavatamrit. Also, we discuss that how Krishna showed Goloka Dham to the Vrajvasis. Yes, he showed the Vrajvasis, Vrindavan Vasis, the Goloka Dham. They want the topmost Vaikuntha planet is Goloka Vrindavan. And he showed them what is Goloka Vrindavan. And after seeing Goloka Vrindavan, they realized that we are actually in Goloka Vrindavan. So we are in the topmost Dham. So their appreciation for their Vrindavan Dham increased much more. right? It increased much more. So this is another thing that we need to understand, that Golok Dham is a part of Vaikuntha only. So Shastras need not every time specifically says, but at the same time, many shlokas, specifically the Golok Dham is also glorified. And there are certain people who entered into the Golok Dham only, like Parikshit Maharaj, he entered Golok Dham. On the other hand, if you see Arjuna went to Vaikuntha, their rasas were different. So we have many evidences like that.
So can I understand it like when Ramananda Rai was asked by Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, like which is the best place? And then he said Mathura and not Brindavan. Is it because Brindavan is in the district of Mathura, right?
Yeah, they call it Mathura Mandal only. See, in Mathura Mandal, there are 12 forests. Dwadasha Kanan, out of which one of the forests is Vrindavan.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. My second question is, Prabhu, Adhyatmik, that word itself is very confusing to me because we see the three material miseries. One of them is Adhyatmik, that is caused by the body and the mind, isn't it?
But Adhyatmik then, also means spirituality.
Yeah.
That is Adhyatma. What is this? Because the word Atma has contextually different meanings. Atma can refer to body, Atma can refer to mind, Atma can refer to intelligence, Atma can refer to ego, Atma also refers to soul. Atmaja means what? Arre, Atma to janam thodi hota hai. Atmaja means one has come from one's body in this context, because that only can be born. So on the other hand, when Manasaputras were being spoken about, Atmaja. So Brahma created them through the mind. Atmaja, those born through mind. Got it, na? So that is why Atma has different contexts. So according to context, it is taken. So in the case of misery, Adhyatma, soul cannot give misery. Na? Soul is Sachidananda. It cannot give misery.
Yeah.
So Adhyatmika Klesha refers to body and mind. They only give misery. Actually, it is the mind which gives misery. Yeah.
Thank you, Prabhu.
Okay, we'll officially conclude here. And in case anyone has any question, they can ask. Else, we will all proceed for our respective activities. Thank you all very much. Jagat Guru Shila Prabhupad ki jai. Bhagavad Vani Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki jai. Anybody else wants to ask?